It's great for football fans that supporters are allowed back in the stadiums, but there is nothing like this, where when the people of God gather together, those who are on their way to heaven, those who know the Lord Jesus Christ, met together in his name, there's no gathering like it. People might come in here and think, oh, it's just a group of people, masks on as usual, but they can't see what's going on. We're a people who, as we gather around and listen to these readings from the scriptures and these songs that are being sung about the incarnation, it's the Christmas story, and it's unashamedly supernatural. That is the title tonight of the message I want to bring. And we come from such a gloomy world, don't we? I mean, is it just exaggerated because on the way here it is dark and it is wet? And we come here, we're still in the body, and we live in an unbelieving world. We're surrounded by unbelief, by a world that is absolutely hopeless, pinning their hopes on a vaccine as if that's going to be the answer to all the world's problems and the answer to death and depression. And we're affected by that because we suffer from toothache and backache and heartache. You know, all the aches we feel. Even though we might be children of God, on our way to glory, we're dragged down by this unbelieving world. But when we come by faith to the scriptures, we enter another world. We enter into the supernatural dimension, and we're reminded that we're not believing just good things. We're coming to the God of the impossible, who years ago, when the world was in darkness, suddenly, there's an invasion of light and hope as the birth of Jesus Christ takes place after many years of prophecy and foretelling. I think as Christians, we're always under pressure just to calm down the supernatural element to our faith. You know, virgin birth, a six-day literal creation, God raising the dead, the judgment day, heaven, hell, and somehow we just sort of tone it all down a bit and we try and make our faith believable to those who are unbelievers, whereas we are unashamedly supernatural. Now, ironically, we live in an age where anything weird and wonderful is accepted. It can be crazy stuff. And people think, well, that's okay. It was G.K. Chesterton years ago who said, when people stop believing in God, they don't believe in nothing, but they believe in anything. Now, we're there now. You can say, I believe in, you know, ridiculous stuff. You know, I can believe in aliens, and I can believe in... you know, little green men, or I can believe in a government that's going to give some sense. No, that does take faith. But, you know, you can believe anything wacky, and it's absolutely acceptable. But you believe in the God of the Bible, you are weird and offensive as well, along with it. But the Christmas story is packed with the supernatural. And we want to embrace it with faith and with joy tonight. Because we're going to look at the very heart of it, and we have been looking at the heart of it. But tonight in particular, we're coming to that point where the Word became flesh. At that conception when the eternal Son of God entered our world and became flesh. And so in Luke chapter 1 now, it's verses 26 to 38... And here is Mary, this young country girl, and she's visited by this angelic being. And when is this? Well, we can read in verse 26, we're told in the sixth month. That is in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. That's a much older cousin who she learns, or she will learn, has become pregnant. So God sends the angel Gabriel. You know, there's a hierarchy in angels, and Gabriel is there right at the top, and he's told to go to Nazareth, to a town in Galilee, and appear to this young servant girl. Now she's terrified, of course. If an angel were to appear in this room tonight, we would be on the floor shaking. This angel that stands in the very presence of Almighty God has come from a holy place called heaven and stands in earth, and we will be quivering and shaking on the floor. But straight away notice that he says, don't be afraid. That's so necessary. Maybe we'll read some of those verses again just so we can get the gist. Now, verse 28, the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son. And you're to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Then he tells her, even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. So notice that he says, you found favor with God. That means grace. We see that word grace in the Bible a lot, don't we? It is God's unmerited favor. It's not that she was sinless, but that she, by grace, was going to be the mother of the Son of God. But she was a godly and a righteous young woman, but she was not sinless. It's by grace, and she has found favor in the Lord's sight. She was going to be honored to carry this unique child. So this young servant girl would give birth to a son. Now, that would be good news, but as Giles reminded us this morning, the scandal surrounding all of this. Oh yes, an angel appeared to you, and there you are, pregnant, and she's just a kid, and she's engaged to a lad who was struggling to grow a beard. You know, we tend to forget they were just kids. They married at 13, 14, 15, 16 then. So this is a tremendous burden, and yet she's going to carry it well. But on top of that, I mean, this is just a human thing now. They were from Nazareth, you know. There was a stigma. If you came from Nazareth, boy, that was the pits. I'd be in danger if I try and pluck out an English town to help us get there. You probably got your own equivalent of Nazareth, haven't you? No, I don't want to be unkind here, but I was reading... I've not been to Huddersfield, but I was reading how there's some cruel words, and this is the advice given. Huddersfield should be avoided by all those who desire to keep their wallets, mobile phones, and most of all their sense of smell. Well, that's cruel, isn't it? If I was from Huddersfield, I'd be offended by that. But there are certain places in our nation, we think, oh, they're from, you know, and I'm from Liverpool, and some people say, you know, the only good thing out of Liverpool's the road. But there are certain towns we have, and there's a stigma attached to it. In fact, in years to come, he will be Jesus of Nazareth. Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth. But Nathanael, remember when the Lord was calling his disciples, and there's Nathanael, and when he hears where Jesus is from, he bursts out, Nazareth? Could anything good come out of Nazareth? So here's a couple from Nazareth. It was from the pits. And here's a young girl from Nazareth. But the entire life of Jesus, from birth to death, shows he came from humble circumstances so that no one need feel excluded. Now, what we see here is that there's something, we call it the virgin birth. Actually, it's not. It's a virgin conception. It was the conception that that was miraculous. The birth would have been like any other mother's birth, painful, and you want to get it over with. It was the conception that was the miraculous part. And we come into the very heart of the incarnation, how the one to be born will be both God and man. This unique being fused together in this baby, in this mother's womb. Verses 34 and 35. How will this be? How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. This is getting the very heart of the act now, isn't it? The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. That word, overshadow, it's an unusual word in the scriptures. It's not found very much, but just to bring out three places where we get the same word. At the end of Exodus, Moses, we read, is unable to enter the tabernacle because of the glory of God that fills that tabernacle. So right at the end of Exodus, it's chapter 40, verse 34, we read, then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could not enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Now that word settled, the cloud settled, and the glory of the Lord. Settle is translated overshadow. It's the same word here in Luke. We get the same word again, that overshadow word, in Psalm 91, verse 4. He will cover you with his feathers. Under his wings you will find refuge. It is that word overshadow. He will cover you with his wings. Then just one more time we see that word. Transfiguration. Jesus on the mount, he's transfigured into this dazzling white being. We read then a cloud. This is Mark 9, 7. A cloud appeared and covered them. Notice the same glory situation now, isn't it? The cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, this is my son whom I love. So we seem to see two things coming together in this act when Mary is overshadowed, when the Most High overshadows her. It seems to be that the presence of God and the protection of God coming into this situation. Just a little aside here, this isn't an unbelief from Mary here. God isn't displeased with her. She's just simply asking, how has this happened? How are you going to do this, God? She's not querying it. She's just, as a virgin, asking, how's God going to do this? And so it's by the Holy Spirit, the Most High. The Holy Spirit is going to come and he will overshadow you. There'll be that union. Then Mary's told that this child, her child, will be great. Verse 32. The angel says he will be great and called the Son of the Most High. Don't we use that word great a bit too often? It's a bit like the American, they're awesome. Everything's awesome. Oh, my dog is awesome. Yeah, all those shoes, they're awesome. Everything's awesome, isn't it? But of course, we're British, everything's great over here. Oh, the weather's great. Yes, I know. My shoes are great. My wife's mask is great. And, Liverpool's great. Of course, yeah, okay. The football club, I mean. Not. But how do we use that same word when it says that Jesus is great? There needs to be another word, doesn't there? John Piper, speaking about this greatness, says, Jesus is great. He is very great. If you took all the greatest thinkers of every country and every century of the world and put them in a room with Jesus, they would shut their mouths and listen to the greatness of his wisdom. All the greatest generals would listen to his strategy. All the greatest musicians would listen to his music theory and performance on every instrument. There is nothing that Jesus cannot do 1,000 times better than the person you admire most in any area of human endeavor under the sun. Words fail to fill the greatness of Jesus. So Gabriel leaves it simple and yet so profound, he will be great. So how do we go into our world and tell people about the greatness of Jesus? Our world is so atheistic in its thinking, so full of arrogance and pride, and needs nothing. Giles reminded us this morning, I'm okay, thanks. I don't need anything. No, I've got no problems in life. I'm not going to die. No, I'm okay. Thank you. Keep me, Jesus. Thank you very much. How can we impress upon people that he is great in a world that's always hyping things up? How do we communicate the greatness of Jesus Christ? And also a world that, a culture, I say a world because when people say, the whole world is atheistic, that's not true. We look around the world, most people are religious. Most cultures have a religion. They believe in a supreme divine being. But we in the arrogant West, we don't believe anything we can't put under a microscope and experiment with. We leave out the supernatural altogether. It's pressed out. And we're saying, but God entered our world. But God has come to rescue us. We're looking for saviors all the time. And we're saying, but here is the savior. He is great. Jesus Christ is great. But then it's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who brought about this union. Only he can show people. Can you remember a time when you thought Jesus wasn't great? And then God comes to us. Can I ask you, when was the first time you really realized that Jesus was great? Can you think back now? When did it first dawn on you? Because I guess that especially if you're from a Christian home and you know all these things, but there comes that moment when the Holy Spirit tells you Jesus Christ is great. For people like me who was drowning in alcohol, to be pulled out, you see the greatness of Jesus in a moment. But then we can all have those moments when we see that Jesus Christ really is great. But without that childlike faith, and this is where the gospel hits. Because unless we have a childlike faith, we never will realize the greatness of this Savior. Hearts are so hard that an arrogant heart will be, in a sense, shielded. Jesus said about this when there were those in those Galilean villages that refused him. He said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and the learned, and you reveal them to little children. There's a kind of a blindness, isn't there? Pride brings about a blindness, whereas a childlike faith opens up to the spiritual things. When I was at Bible College, the principal there was a great Hebrew scholar. I use the word great again, didn't I? See? He was really accomplished. Anyway, I'll get on. But he was an accomplished, revered Hebrew scholar. And people would talk in hushed and revered terms about Mr. Waite. And he was a gracious, godly man. And I remember I was in his study one day. I was talking to him. And while we were chatting, I was talking to Mr. Waite. The caretaker's little three-year-old crawled along the floor and shouts out to John Waite, John! 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 I said, excuse me, it's Mr. Waite. No, I didn't. But John Waite bends down, picks up this little three-year-old, sits him on his lap, and they have a chat together. Now, we see in the smallest measure, people who are great in this world, as we might say, and yet it just is a shadow of the God who stoops down to accommodate our ignorance and sinfulness to lift us up. And this is the heart of the incarnation, that God leaves heaven where the Son of God is praised and adored, and he enters into this cesspit of a world where he's going to be mocked and spat upon and rejected, finally nailed to a cross and mocked some more. And God's going to take our sin and lay it on him and give him hell in our place. Now, boy, this is the gospel, isn't it? Who would believe this? Charles Wesley wrote, "The humble poor believe. Those with childlike, desperate hearts." It's almost pitiable, isn't it? It's heartbreaking. The solutions, you know, you watch the TV and people say, yeah, what we want during this time is more comedians, more entertainers, more parties. You know, when will we learn that we need a saviour? We need hope. We need forgiveness. We need joy. And this Christmas time, that is what God is offering. So just to close, here is this young servant girl and her reaction to this revelation. The angel reassures us, verse 37, that God can do it. He says, "For nothing is impossible with God." And he's saying that this is the God of all creation, the God who created the universe. He's going to come to you, Mary. It's not too hard for him. You know, God can take a person like your elderly relative and give her a baby. God can take a virgin like you, Mary, and give you a son. So she comes in this childlike faith and accepts. "I am the Lord's servant," she says. "May it be as you have said." Isn't that a tremendous attitude to have? I wonder what's happening in your life now. Maybe inwardly you're struggling with it and you're fighting against it. And where God is the same, will you trust me? She simply says, "I don't understand this, but I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." So, Advent, Christmas, whatever we're going to call it, but just a time to concentrate on the wonder of the incarnation. And when our minds struggle to really understand this, all we can do is worship, isn't it? We just bow down and worship. Say, "Lord, this is incredible." Charles Wesley wrote in that lovely hymn, "Let earth and heaven combine, angels and men agree, to praise in songs divine, to incarnate deity. Our God contracted to a span." A span is from the tip of the thumb to the tip of the little finger. "Our God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man." So, do you enjoy this time of year? You know, we need to concentrate, because soon it'll be gone and we'll get on to other things, but really we're almost forced. No, we gladly submit to that pressure, but we are forced to consider, to wrestle with the incarnation, all that it meant for God to enter into our world. So let's pray now. Father, we pray by your Spirit you would come to us and give us a greater understanding of this, Lord. Not that we can ever grasp it, but we want to worship you more. So we pray that your Spirit will come and peel off some layers of unbelief, Lord. May we not be ashamed to admit that we believe these things. And in an unbelieving world, we might go forward and go forth with such joy and hand out such hope as all the hope and blessing we find in Jesus Christ. Give us opportunities, we pray, to speak of these things in the coming days. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.